Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and willingly magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. said to them, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do, for I have no place to store my crops?" Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry.'" But God said to him, "You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be?" So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Please be seated. When I was a boy, my father used to tell a story, which he swore was true, about our family's move from the Midwest to Florida before there were interstate highways, when local or state roads were all we had. As we traveled through one southern state, he said we came to a bridge over a river that separated a dry county from a wet county. At the foot of the bridge in the dry county was a church whose sign read, "Jesus is coming soon, get ready." On the wet county side of the bridge was a tavern whose sign read, "Come in and have a beer while you wait." If it isn't true, it should be, right? So what I want to suggest to you today is that although planning for our future or learning from our past are both important, what we do in the meantime also matters. That this very day, and every day perhaps, our lives are demanded of us in terms of our faith. There are several versions of the good life that Americans hope to live. One is where we realize that nothing is as valuable as love. Love of God, love of one another. For Christians, as we move forward in our faith journey, there is the life that we dream of and the one that God dreams for us. First, a couple of quotations about wealth. Winston Churchill is supposed to have said, "We make a living by what we get, but we make a life by what we give." And a deacon I worked with used to say, "You never see a hearse with a U-Haul trailer behind it." Well, if you paid attention in the readings, there's all kinds of things about wealth and about the rich, the wealthy. The Bible doesn't always have a very good view of people who are rich, but we're going to take that apart a little bit and find out why. At the heart of today's parable in the gospel is an abundant harvest, which is a good thing. But we suspect from the start that this is unlikely, because we know from Jesus' introduction that the landowner is rich. Other references in the Gospels about the rich are almost uniformly negative and almost always contrasted with positive references to the poor. The rich are portrayed as beyond hope in the parable of the rich man and poor Lazarus,
where in response to the rich man's request that Lazarus be sent to warn his brothers, Abraham says that if they haven't listened to Moses and the prophets, they won't be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. And when the rich young ruler asks Jesus the way to eternal life, he tells him to sell his possessions and give the money to the poor, which seems to be the one thing the young man cannot do. Well, given this view of wealth, we are not hopeful about this rich landowner, that how he will handle his abundance. Confronted with this happy problem of a bumper crop, he thinks about his own needs and concludes that the answer is to build bigger barns for his crops and his other goods. Then he looks forward to congratulating himself on this decision as he and his soul, with all that accumulated wealth, spend many happy years eating, drinking, and making merry. But it's also important to see how Jesus analyzes things in this parable. The rich man in the story is not criticized so much for storing up his treasures. He is criticized for not being rich towards God. I think we are so used to being grateful for the abundant ways in which God has blessed us that we can forget that this goes both ways. Part of discovering our true own lives is to give gifts back to God and back to the world. Now, we could easily argue that the rich man is wise and responsible. He has a thriving farming business. His land has produced so abundantly that he doesn't have enough storage space, so he plans to pull down the barns and build bigger ones. Then he'll have ample savings set aside for the future, and he can enjoy his golden years. And isn't that what we're encouraged to strive for? Isn't that wise and responsible to save for the future? The rich farmer would probably make a good financial advisor. He seems to have things figured out. He has worked hard. He has saved wisely. Now he can sit back and enjoy the fruits of his labor. But the thing the rich man apparently has not planned for is what he will do with his abundance. In the meantime, he is so focused on this one goal that anything that's happening in the here and now is not even in his thinking. He is a fool, says the gospel, not because he is wealthy or because he saves for the future, but because he appears to live only for himself and because he believes he can secure his own future with abundant possessions. In our culture, things like money and insurance and education and stability and other sorts of personal resources are part of how we define personal safety and protection for us and for our family. Storing up treasures is fine as far as it goes. But our real value as Christians is what we risk living into our faith. What are we willing to let go of? What are we willing to hold lightly? And as far as I can tell, being rich towards God involves some very specific tasks. Above all, loving God and each other. But also things like forgiveness, generosity, compassion, and hospitality. Which leads me to another interesting detail in this gospel story. Notice the little dialogue that goes on with the rich man in the parable. He's talking to himself. It's all this kind of inner dialogue. The only person he refers to is himself. What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods. It is telling that as the subject of Jesus' story, he is making plans with what to do with his abundance. He's not talking to a spouse, a child, a sibling, a trusted neighbor, or God. He is all alone. The last decision he will make before he dies. In fact, it strikes me that the tragedy of this story is not only that he died too soon, but that maybe he never really lived. Becoming a steward instead of an owner allows me to use my gifts in ways that matter. When you have your stewardship later on in the fall, remember that. We are stewards, not so much owners. And I can be a steward even after I die by good planning of what happens to my resources. Stories like this one in the gospel find me wondering if I have really learned that lesson, if I have really learned that about myself, about my call to be a steward in the time that I have been given. Because I sometimes have the same idea as this man. As long as I can keep getting, I can hold back giving. And I can hold back even giving to God. It seems to me that as the prodigal son story is about a young man's journey between his reality and his spiritual stability, this story is about us older folks. It's about what my wife calls our Act 3 in life, our spiritual journey in those latter years, this stage when we have less time ahead of us than we do behind us. Jesus offers us priorities to discover the dream that God has for us, the kingdom of God that meets us here and now, the journey to find our best life and our true life's value. So if Churchill was right, that we make a living by what we gather and earn, and we make a life by how we give and are grateful, then what does God need for you to be doing in the meantime? Where might your life be demanded of you? What gifts do you need to bring to mind on either of those questions? Where do the needs of others and your own deep joy meet one another? Amen. Please join me in reciting the Nicene Creed as an affirmation of our faith.
Just a reminder about communion. According to your all's protocols, those who would like to either have the bread only, a blessing, or use intention of dipping the bread, be on this side, please. Opposite. Okay. I remembered it. Toilet pilot. Okay. You're on this side. to suffer.